Hey. You guys hear that? This is America. Don't get you slipping up. Don't get you slipping up. Hey. You guys can hear that? I gotta be intense, yo. We're living in some crazy intense times. I gotta carry him. When you come in here, take off your shoes, relax, clear your mind. This is an all love zone. There's no hate here. It's all love. Yo, Quincy, I see you. I see you, Quincy. What's up, brother? How you been, man? What's up? What's up? Thea, what's up? How are you? I haven't seen you in years. Oh, Joanna, how are you? Good to see you. What's up, Marcus? How you doing? Oh, our guest of honor is in the building. Mr. Kwaku Amuti. He is in the building, you guys. Hi, Stephanie. Welcome. Hey, I'm going to bring my guest of honor in the building. Hey. Kwaku, request me. And I'll bring you in. I'll bring you into the apartment. Hey, there we go. Hey, what's up, Jerry? Welcome. Hey. What's up, brother?
Man, what it do, bro?
How you doing, man? Good to see you.
Oh, man, it's good to be seeing. Good to see you too, man. I'm honored to be doing this. I believe, am I the first non-fashion person to do this amazing show?
Why, yes, you are, sir.
There we go.
Yes, you are. People,
man, you know what I mean?
Yes, sir. Well, look, you are an amazing human being. So,
wow.
It is, it's my honor to have you. When I consider brotherhood, I consider you to be a strong brother. Not only that, but a strong brother to me. So I have an interest in gleaning and learning from you. So I thank you.
Listen, man, we're all students in this thing called life, man. And, yes, and I mean that. So nobody gets it right. But I'm you know, every time we get to breathe, man, we all have a gift. We all have something to, you know, to learn and something to give. So absolutely. I'm happy to learn something from you today and give something to you too.
Oh, man, I hope so. It's all about the exchange, man. It's all about the exchange. Yeah, definitely. Let me welcome some more guests. I see Jennifer, Namani, I see you. Hi, Courtney, how are you?
Hey, everybody.
Hey, Renee, how are you? Good to see you guys. Thank you guys for joining. This edition of Taylor Talks is with my homie, my friend, my brother, Mr. Kwaku Amuti. This guy is so amazing, and he has something special to say. And one of the reasons why I even began this or resurfaced this was because I wanted to talk to my special friends who had something special to say and something special to share with people, especially in such a time as this where, you know, people are hurting, people are dying, people are, you know, risking their lives to go and be on the front lines for us. You know, people are I don't even know what the word is they're unlawfully dying.
Yeah.
For just being who they are. And we're living in some really interesting, very, very interesting and somewhat scary times.
Well, I mean, that's a really good place to jump in, man, because I mean, in all reality, what's scary about these times for the majority of people these days have actually been scary for Black people for the majority of our lives.
Our lives.
So
and our families, our parents. Yes. Lives.
And so there's this kind of bob and weave that we've always had to do to make sure that we can just get the basics, you know, just, and a lot of people it's just for survival or whatever, but you know, we're in a new age. And I actually, interestingly enough, I was having a conversation the other day about it. I'm grateful for technologies like this.
Yeah.
Because it is shedding light on what's been going on. There's no hiding from video.
Yeah. It is, you know, what it is. It's captured.
Yeah. So
it is essentially a moment that has been captured in real time that can be shared out of real time.
Right. And it's hard to ignore it when it's on video, but then it's also hard to ignore it when you get to experience it yourself. Like I say to my wife a lot, my beautiful wife, shout out to Sybil.
Hey, what's up, Sybil?
that I will never, ever, as a man, I will never, ever understand what it's like to be pregnant and to give birth.
Yeah.
That is not something that I was blessed to be able to do.
Yeah.
But that doesn't stop me from trying my hardest to understand where she is, mm-hmm, and ask questions. And even sometimes you can go as far these days as going to get the pregnant stomach and the backpack thing you can wear.
Like so a simulator.
Yeah, so that you can walk a mile in their shoes, at least a half a mile.
Yeah.
So this time is extremely important. The whole thing about the violent protests and things like that, you know, in my mind, I always say that, like, and a friend of mine actually says this, when a pipe bursts, you can't tell it where to spray water.
That's good.
There, you know.
When a pipe bursts, you can't tell it where to spray water.
No.
That's good. I just want people to marinate on that. But no, seriously, when a pipe bursts, you can't tell it where to spray water. That is so profound and it's so simple. But I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I that was something, a friend of mine gave that to me, a really good friend of mine gave that to me. And it calmed me down when I was thinking about all of the violence that I was seeing, all of that stuff. Because, you know, I'm a generally peaceful person. I get angry, I get upset like everybody.
Yes, you
but are. Then when you started seeing things, you have to kind of make up your mind about where things are, like where you are with these things. And when he told me that, it calmed me. I don't want to see buildings burn. I don't want to see people shot. I don't want to see any of that. You know, I'd love for this thing to be a peaceful thing. But at the end of the day, like, that was the one that calmed me, when the pipe is burst.
Yeah.
So now water is spewing all over the place in different cities, on different streets, in different businesses. But, you know, the first thing you do when that happens is you actually go and cut off the water source.
Hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you naturally, you wouldn't just let it be.
You gotta run and cut off the source, yeah.
Yeah, so what I love that's happening now is that, and I'm sorry if we're getting off topic, but if everybody, the cool thing that I see that's happening right now is that more people are starting to get into the experience of what it is to be a Black person in America these days, you know?
Agreed.
And so what they're doing is what a lot of us may not even have the power to do. They're going to the you know, the water source, and they're working on ways to turn it off so that at least we can start fixing the pipe. Because when a pipe bursts, here's the thing, and when a pipe bursts, if you don't just tape it, you have to get a whole new pipe.
Yeah.
We need a whole, you know, and I'm not a plumber, so plumbers that get on, they'll, you know, they may,
of course,
whatever.
I mean, but I mean, metaphorically speaking, like, yeah, this is illuminating it for me. And it's made it clear for me because it's an illustration. And, you know, and I agree with you. I think there's so many range of emotions as it relates to, and I think a lot of opinions that are surfacing now, a lot of people are kind of, you know, I think the protests should be peaceful. I think the protests are just fine. I think that the looting and, you know, all of that is a result of, you know, people having pent up energy and anger, and, you know, they want to see the world in a better place. So they're like, F it. Like, I'm getting ready to just go ham. You know what right. I mean? And I think that we're just in so much desperation for change that it's kind of like no holds barred at this point. It's like people are doing some of everything to just get the attention of the people. They're trying to go to the source. They're trying to go to the pipe.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. They're trying to get in and infiltrate a system that's already for many years been sick and twisted and demented and not in favor of everyone, but in favor of the majority. And look, we can go into that like so
you
many
know how we do.
Like this is my brother Kwaku Amuti for everyone.
Well, no, but really quickly though, the fun thing I've come to understand, and this is probably this, unless we go there again, it's the last thing I say about this part, it's that the system isn't broken. It's actually been working the way that it was designed. It's not broken.
That part.
Now, it's working the way that it was designed to benefit a certain group of people.
Yes.
But we are in a space in America right now where that does not work. And what happened is we've created this critical mass of people who have said, this does not work, this does not work. And now we see what's happening.
Jeez.
But anyway, let's talk about Brotherhood.
People are showing out and showing up and, you know, coming out of the woodworks. And, you know, I appreciate it. And, you know, I think, and I want to touch on this too. Eventually, I want to touch on this about some people that you never expected are kind of coming up and saying things or whatever, you know, Black and non-Black people, but particularly non-Black people who some of them don't even know what to say. They don't know how to get involved. They don't know how to join in and fight the fight. You know, they're scared of saying the wrong things. So I want to just put that there.
Yes. And
I want to revisit that in a second, but okay. I want to just say, you know, you're a son, you're a husband, you're a father, and you're my brother. I even wore my favorite t-shirt.
Oh, I see,
My favorite t-shirt here, and I wore it specifically for you. Aside from that, you're a creative genius.
Wow.
Graphics, marketing, just... creative genius. I love that about you. You're an entrepreneur, and you're a founder of this wonderful platform for men of color, and it's called Proverb. And, you know, before we even really get started, I kind of want you to just touch on a little bit about and share with people exactly what Proverb is.
I'll go back. Men in general are broken, and we don't like to admit it. We are born into competition. We are devoid of, you know, most of us, and again, I'm speaking generalization, but most of us are in a space where communication has never been at premium as, you know, during our developmental years.
Yes.
So consequently, we learn that when we're hurt, we take all of these emotions and we just put them down. And we put them down and put them down and put them down and put them down. And the metaphor that I always think about when that happens is, it's like packing dynamite. So you have this piece, this stick of dynamite, and then all it takes is one thing to set it off and everything comes out.
Boom.
Now,
boom.
That's literally just men. Imagine pouring on top of that dynamite, packing that dynamite with institutionalized racism, with the lack of father figures, with, you know, you name it, we got it,
yeah.
Right? And so that makes it doubly hard for Black men to be able to even be in a space to receive the information that they need to grow and be beneficial to not only themselves, but their families, their communities, and the world. Mm-hmm. So a number of years ago, I had a startling thought. I thought to myself, I have an 11-year-old, an amazing 11-year-old son.
Yes.
And I thought to myself, if I died, what could I give him? What things could I leave for him that would be able to guide him through the rest of his life? And at that time, there was nothing. I taught him everything I could. We spent time together, but mm-hmm. there was no group of men. There was nothing that he could kind of grab onto. And so then I started thinking, okay, well, if my son who has me in his life as a father can have that, then, you know, and he doesn't have much to go on if I die, what about the young black man who doesn't have a father, the young black boy who doesn't have a father? So he all of a sudden gets into a cycle that is going to just have him, you know, it's going to lead him to two places. He's either going to get killed or he's going to go to jail. Yep. So I said, well, what does that look like? How do I use the skills that I have, my soft skills? And then how do I use the skills that I've learned to kind of build something? And so the first thing I started deciding to do was, let me just put a group together of men. I know a bunch of extraordinary black men who do any and everything from mm-hmm. yourself to, you know, your musicians, I know artists, I know, you know, lawyers, doctors, but we were all so disparate. So it'd be, I could go hang out with you, but then I'm gonna go hang out with a couple of other guys here and a couple other guys here. And we never pulled together. So the thought came to me, what would happen if we took all of those resources that we had, all of those skills and talents, and we all started bringing them together and sharing them with one another? That's how villages are born.
Yes.
So we started it in 2016, and we started, and I thought it was just going to be, I sent an invitation out with this manifesto. I sent it out to maybe 10 of my friends, and I thought it would only just be 10. But that 10 turned into 20, turned into 30, turned into 50, and now we are, I'm so pleased. A couple of guys have logged on, and thank you, and you know, to those proverb guys.
Oh, cool.
We are almost at
900. Building proverb.
We're almost at 900 men, and
wow.
Yeah. So now we've got a new challenge. Now the challenge is delivering on the promise every day of being able to engage them and being able to challenge them, being able to give them information they need and help them grow.
Man, I tell you, this is, and so whenever you got this idea in your mind and it became real to you, were there, I mean, I'm sure there are fears, and I don't want to, you know, speak that into you or whatever, but, you know, there's that notion of like, I have this idea, I want to bring these brothers together, I want there to be bonding, I want, you know, all the things that you said you wanted.
Yeah.
Was there hesitation? Did you think it would be successful?
No, I 100% thought it was going to fail in a real and honest place, and I'm okay saying that because, you know, it's that's going to help somebody who has that in their mind, something great that they know they've been given that they have to do. But then the first thing that happens is doubt. I mean, believe me, I still deal with doubt. I still do.
Yeah. I mean,
and it's funny how, you know, all of this is going to bring us to our topic, but one of the things that inspires me the most to keep going is the level of brotherhood that I see within the group.
Wow.
Like, it's up to each other. If men would embrace each other, black men would embrace each other like they are. I had no idea, but I knew the part of it that I had to accomplish. And the part of it that I accomplished was, the first part was starting it. Just doing it when it feels unbelievable. And some of the inspiration I even got from that was, think about it, you and I are communicating on a device that wasn't possible at one point.
That's
so
true.
Like, someone had to come up with this concept and be completely crazy and think outside of the box and imagine a world where somebody could have a device in their pocket that could connect them to their friends and loved ones. You know what I'm saying? So for this, yeah, I thought I was absolutely nuts for doing it. Absolutely. And I thought that it would just be me and a couple of my friends gathering around and just, we're talking about old high school stories. But
yeah.
But when other men started, you know, showing up,
hold on for 1 second. I can't hear you. I can hear you now, though.
You have me?
Yep, I got you, man. You're good.
You good?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
It's
analogy, dude.
It's like,
okay,
a.
So that makes, that brings you to another point, which is fun. Okay. Well, we can listen. Let's call it technology, and I'm good.
Gotcha. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Let me just make sure that I'm not exactly sure what's going on. I can hear you now. You can hear me?
Yeah, no worries, bro.
Perfect, okay, perfect.
Yep, I can hear you.
Yeah, it's definitely technology. Okay, cool. Well, look, before we go any further, I want to define brotherhood, because I think as a result of you using this technological, you know, platform, this device, this, you know, Instagram, you know, whatever the case may be, a podcast, all the things that fall under the umbrella of what you provide at Proverb. And Proverb is spelled phonetically too. I want you to share that, and, you know, where they can find you and look you up later. But I want to define brotherhood, and I want to define the root of, you know, the word, which is brother. So, you know, I looked up in good old Webster's Dictionary, which reads a boy or a man with siblings. That's kind of like the basic form of being a brother. A person who shares something in common with another person, which is spot on. You talked about that a little bit earlier. And one related to another with common ties or common interests. The definition of brotherhood, or some definitions of brotherhood, are the relationship between brothers, which is a basic form of brotherhood. I think that's kind of an understood. And then the second one is an association, society, or community of people linked by a common interest, religion, trade, you know, all of those things, et cetera. I want to add to that I believe that when you get the basic concept of brotherhood, the basic concept of being a brother, I think the root of it is love. Mm-hmm. I think at the foundational level, it's love. And well, first of all, would you agree with that?
I would agree, and I'm glad that you said that, because it is not like, it is love. They live in two different houses.
Two different things.
Yeah. My brothers, I don't have to like the things you do. I don't have to like the things you say. you know what I mean? But I am required to love you. If you are my brother, I am required to love you. And we can fight out the rest of that stuff later. But love is not, we don't negotiate love. Me and my brothers, we do not negotiate love at all. It is how many, like, bro, I love you, but you're wrong.
Yeah. How many siblings do you have? Or how many brothers do you have?
I only have one. I have the greatest brother in the world. He's absolutely
amazing. That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. I have an older sister, and so I am a brother to her. But I don't have any biological brothers. But I've always wanted a biological brother. So I feel like I find myself falling into a brotherly role with, you know, younger and older, you know, with you, you know, whenever we met, you know, God knows how long ago, I felt like this guy's really smart. He's really intelligent. Wow. And I can learn something from him. And, you know, fast forward to where I am now, I'm a little bit older, a little wiser. I've lived, and I see the same thing in some younger guys, some younger brothers, that I'm like, you know, I see that they're on the right path. I see that they're wanting to do great and wonderful things. If there's something in me that I can do or share with them to help them along their journey, to make it a little bit easier for them, then I want to do that. And the root of that for me is love, because I try to lead with love. and you hit on a topic earlier about competition.
Yeah.
And brotherhood is not, it's not competition. It is not competition whatsoever.
And, well, and to a degree, we that's why we as men have to uncompetition part.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're raised to think that, okay, my brothers are just my teammates and we are going against our adversaries, another team doing literally at the end of the day. And you said something actually, I want to, when you see younger brothers, or if I have something in me, take the if off. Brotherhood says, I have in me. There is something that I can contribute to that man, to that brother. And vice versa, if he takes that off too, because the if can keep you in a space where, you know, couple that if with the fact that we don't communicate, and that's where the trouble starts.
Yeah.
I will say, well, if he needs something, then, you know, hold on, we're doing it again, I think, right? Can you hear
me? Yeah. It's weird. I can hear you, but you're frozen. Say something. I can't.
Can you see me? Can you hear me moving? There we go.
I can see
you back.
Yeah. We're good. If it gets too bad, then we'll close out and then we'll start. But I think it's fine.
Yeah, and then we can start over that night. where a lot of the problems with brotherhood start is that it's where it's like you get with a group of guys, you get with, well, if he needs something, then I'll provide it. But what if you came to the scenario or the situation with just the thought of, hey, there's something he needs and I can add it. And he comes with, there's something he needs and I can add it. Then an exchange starts to happen. And I can honestly tell you with all of my really close brotherhood, you know, my close brotherhood relationships, we have that. There's no asking. There's like a space where we all exist and we're there for one another in a very natural way. And when you spend enough time with guys like that, you start to learn their cues. So like, I've got a really good friend, and when he starts going quiet, I know. So then I can say, oh, well, dude, what's going on? And he's like, oh, nothing. Nah, dude, sound like something's going on. And then here it comes.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that as men, if we can start getting out of our own ways and breaking those roadblocks, I think that brotherhood starts to become, because I really think that brotherhood is our inclination. It's just that we're taught something else.
I agree.
When we look at like the fundamental building of the system, it is manhood. And let me say this, brotherhood is pure and natural, but we are taught it. We're taught how to be men by broken men themselves.
So it's just a cycle of brokenness of brokenness.
Right. Because what can a broken man teach you? He can give you as much positive, you know, affirmation, and he can try to fill you up with everything that he can. But if he's capped out, there's nothing else he can give you.
No.
So the rest of what he can teach you is his brokenness. You know what I mean? Well, and that's not even just men. That's humans. Because I don't want this to be this is not a toxic masculinity conversation.
No,
that's just
no.
Human beings.
Well, even with that, going into that, you know, when I think of brotherhood, I think, you know, overarchingly, you know, there's the term brotherhood is not just, yes, we are talking about men, and yes, we've isolated it into, you know, just kind of that bucketed topic, but overarching topic, brotherhood, brotherly love, sisterly love, you know, that fraternal, that, you know, that everyone is in this together. Everyone is feeling a certain way. Everyone is feeling, you know, just the fact that we've been in quarantine for, you know, 90 plus days. Like, everyone is in this. Everyone's in the same fraternity right now, house by house. room alpha room. Like everyone is in the same space, and everyone's experiencing the, you know, a myriad of different things. But we're all, you know, kind of trapped with our thoughts, and you know, we get the pleasure, depending on how you look at it, you get the pleasure of spending time with loved ones and family and friends. But for some other people, it's tumultuous. They're like, I'm trapped in my head. I'm in my thoughts. I have anxiety. You know, as a brother, speaking not just to a man, but just to people in general who are all experiencing ups and downs during this time, like, how would you pour into people now? People who are watching right now, how would you pour into them as a brother, from a brother to another?
Well, I think that one of the ills that has plagued our society is expectation. And by expectation, I mean we go into scenarios and situations with people, and we season them with our own expectations. So I expect you to say a certain thing. I expect you to think a certain thing. I expect you to be a certain person. And these are all constructs that are living in my own mind. Mm-hmm. So then when you say something or you do something, if, you know what I mean, that is contrary to what I believed out of you, then all of a sudden, and especially in this culture, like, I'm ready to cancel you. I'm ready to get rid of you. I'm ready to do all this kind of stuff. I'm ready to completely tear you to pieces.
Throw the whole person away.
Right. Let's just throw the whole person away. Can't start over, but let's just throw them away. But the thing that really combats that ill is replacing expectation with just plain appreciation. I am not, you know, and this is for everybody. I am not you. I am not like you. I don't do the things you do. I don't eat what you eat. I don't say what you say. I don't do. That's cool. But what I do is I appreciate you. I appreciate you're different because.
Say that again.
Go ahead.
Replacing expectation with appreciation.
Uh-huh.
I hope people are writing that down. Please write that down.
We don't do that enough. I mean, look, I'll tell you honestly, in a very transparent place, that is what has really been like the cornerstone of my wonderful marriage. Like, it's not perfect at times, even with my wife. I don't understand her, and I probably never will sometimes. But
that's a whole nother topic.
I know that I can. There are things about her that I can, you know what I mean? Like, I can. But appreciation doesn't cost me anything. It doesn't cost me anything.
Yeah.
But expectations can cost me everything. So, in this environment right now, you know, I know there are people who, like you said earlier, there are people who want to make change but are afraid to because they're afraid to offend someone.
Yes.
And my wife actually put up a Facebook post that was phenomenal, where she addressed people who did not look like her.
Okay.
And in it, she gave them 3 to 4 questions that they can ask her or any one of the people that look like her, any black person, in order to get a real and true conversation started.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the kind of stuff, like we need everything else that's been going on too. So I'm not trying to say, hey, we just need this one and not that one. We actually need all of them.
Yeah.
If we're going to surround the problem that America has and fix it and actually get to work in fixing it and understanding it doesn't take one night, it doesn't take 8 nights. We're having to undo years of a certain system.
Yes, 100 years.
But replacing expectation with appreciation is a really fine in getting there, you know.
Yeah. Got it. So even going a little deeper in that, and I mentioned earlier about, I don't think I said it specifically, but I think we keep hearing this term allies. And mm-hmm. I think, you know, an ally is synonymous with being a brother, being, you know, you know, friends, being family, and I want to relanguage it. I kind of want to redefine it. And, you know, I know that I can't sit on this soapbox and say, I'm redefining ally, you know, and not understand that it takes time for a relanguaging of, you know, a certain construct. But when I hear the word ally, I hear something that's outside of the group. And I mean, I think that's really what the definition really truly is of an ally. But what I'm looking more for is a brotherhood. And that's with, you know, white folks, that's with Latinos, that's with Asian, that's with Indian, that's with Native American, that is with everyone, the whole entire human race. I'm looking for a word to come up with that replaces ally, because I feel like it's so overused it's an understatement for what we need. Mm-hmm. We don't necessarily need allies. We need for you to feel what we feel. You may not be able to feel 100%, but to really have empathy and understand, like, there's a lot that's going on. And, you know, sometimes the silence of it is just, like, unacceptable. Mm-hmm. And I'm sorry, just like a whole rant, but how do you
go
feel?
Go for it, bro. Go for it.
How do you feel about the word ally?
I know that it is like the buzzword that we're using now, but I do think that to a degree it is good, because an ally, and so for me, in my own mental definition, an ally can provide me with support that I cannot provide for myself.
Okay.
So it is like, because for me, brother is a very, it's almost like a covenant term. If I use brother with you, whether you are white, black, you know, Latino, whatever, that means we have gone beyond just a cordial relationship. And now I am, because of all races, I'm willing to join the fray. Like, if this thing were switched, I would be able to jump in the fray. But I do think that personally, I do think allies are absolutely necessary. They've been necessary, but I'm grateful that we're getting them now. You know, I'm not going to be one that, you know, that when I finally do get the ally, I'm not going to shoot them in the back while they're fighting with me. So okay. I have to be able to, I think it was amazing. I think that, it was Dave Chappelle in a special. He said, he was talking about how Desmond Tutu and Nelson Mandela came through, and apartheid should have been a bloodbath. But they sat down and realized that you don't attack the people for whom the system was benefiting them. What you do is you attack the system. Because if you can attack the system and change the system, and that's what allies help us do. If you can attack and change the system, then what happens is, at that point, the system will create a new reward system and everyone else will have to get in line. And you know, the paradigm will shift for those who had benefit before.
Okay.
And then
okay.
This will turn into, okay, so now here's the new way, the newly defined way in order to get benefit in this new society. And at that point, that's how things start shifting. But as long as those rewards from that system still exist, we will never change. But allies can get farther along than I can. So, like, I need the companies. I'll be honest with you, a very, very true story. About 2 or 3 days ago, a friend that I had met one time in LA and had a deep connection with, who happened to be a white man, he owns a company, a fashion clothing company. Okay. And he wrote me the most sincere text message saying, look, I want to put out a message, but I want to make sure that I'm not tone deaf in saying it. And I understand that I am white. So his recognition of who he was and the privilege he had turned this into a really great conversation. He said, Can you help me? Can I send you what I want to send? Tell me what to say. And when I got it, things that were missing, there were some glaring things that as a black man would have sent me to a different place. And so I rewrote and crafted this message for him. He fully accepted it. We had a conversation about it the next day, and his brand released the statement. But after that, this is why I consider him an ally. He said, how do we continue this on? Because this is what we need to move forward, to really move forward. So no, I'm sorry, I'm very long-winded, but allies are absolutely...
No.
Allies to me are really great, really, really great. But I have to make sure that because I've gone through the widest range of emotions for the longest amount of time about the senseless killings, I have to make sure that I can express myself fully to my allies, but then also, you know, and let them know how I feel, but then also not shoot them in the back when they're trying to help me.
So now what would you say, because I want to stay there for a second too, and I've seen a lot on social media where people say, you know, I shouldn't have to tell you what to say. You should go off, do the research, figure out your life, figure out what you stand for, figure out what you believe, then come back and then tell me, you know, how you feel about, you know, whatever the case. We'll say Black Lives Matter, you know, senseless killings of Black men and Black women and people of color. What do you say to that? Because, like, I think it's just where I am a sponge for knowledge, and I'm always trying to educate myself. I'm always trying to stretch myself and, like, my peers, people around me, and, you know, to a certain degree, you know, you've just kind of helped me to shift my focus from, like, oh, I want to relanguage the word allies to, you know, actually, it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's not really a bad word. It's just a different, you know, it's a different perspective, and I'm able to receive your perspective wholeheartedly. But again, my question for you is, I've heard and I've seen some people get so mad at people who don't know what to say. And in your case, you were able to kind of have a conversation with someone that you felt close to say, well, this is what you need to say. Don't leave this part out, you know, and that person took it a step further to want to do the work and go. But what do you say to the person who's just like, I shouldn't tell you what to say. Go figure it out yourself and then come back.
Well, I honor the emotion that individuals feel when they feel like that, because that is, you know, I get it. You're angry. You're disgusted at what's been going on the whole nine. I'm there. My point of view on it, and this is only me, it's that, and I've thought this way before we had any of what's going on in our country, you know, currently going on, but it's, if I am the one who knows better, then I should always be the first one to do better. I'm responsible to do better. So if you don't know about my culture, you coming to me, I don't make you better by shunning you and saying, you know what I mean, and getting upset with you. You've actually put your down to come and ask me. So I can at least honor that with, you know, hey, but you have to be honest about your feelings. You have to be honest about, you know, the things you're going through. I think I froze, but can you still hear me?
I can hear you now. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You jammed for a little bit. Can you see me? Can you hear me?
Are we back?
Yeah, I think we're back. We just got caught up in the matrix.
No, that's good. No, I stopped.
I appreciate that. Let me read this. Let me read this quote. The quote reads, and this is from
those individuals.
You were getting ready to say something about for those individuals.
No, what I was saying was for those individuals who feel like, you know, not up to them to help those who don't know. I would say sending individuals like that off to go, you know, quote unquote, learn it themselves it's really, they may or come back to you with, you know, with that same heartbeat or that same, you want them, you expect them to come back and have absorbed our culture and know the oppression and understand it and feel it and come back and say, I completely empathize with you. I don't believe that that is always the case. If I can educate you in the moment, I will educate you in the moment. I will say, hey, okay, well, do you have a minute? Because there's a lot we have to unpack.
There's a lot to unpack.
But I'm always going to be open and honest with you and allow you to ask me any questions you need to and say, there's no offense here. I'll tell you when I get offended, but I can't cut you for coming to me and asking me a question about this. Do you know what I mean? Because you haven't had to live it for your whole life. So how in the world do I expect you to understand it? You know?
True. No, it's true.
You know, but that's my, when people come to me and ask me those questions, because I know what the experience is like, I have a duty to inform those who want to know.
Yeah.
Because that's really the way you create empathy, the way you create an ally, the way you create a brother is by doing that, in my opinion. Sending them off, me getting angry at them and sending them off doesn't make them any more of an ally or brother to me in the future.
I like that. I like that a lot. I think, let me read this quote. So the quote is from Frederick Douglass, and he says, a smile or a tear has not nationality. Joy and sorrow speak alike to all nations, and they, above all the confusion of tongues, proclaim the brotherhood of man. And if I had to dissect what that quote is saying, is that, you know, we all cry, we all smile, we all have experienced joys and sorrows, and the simple fact that we're humans, you know, should bring us together a little bit closer. And I think you had mentioned something about differences before, but do you think that we're more alike than we are different?
Yes, absolutely. I think that our differences, I do think we are different, but at the end of the day, the core of every single person is absolutely the same. I mean, if you took away all of those things that make us different, whether it be skin color, whether it be, you know, whatever it is, we are at the, you know, even physiologically, we are made up of all the same things. Mm-hmm. Nobody has different blood. Nobody has different, you know what I mean? They may be shaped different, but it's the same fundamental, physiologically, it's the same fundamental pieces. But even still, at the end of the day, like you said, we all laugh, we all cry. There's so many things we do that are the same. And just a few that are different about us. So I do believe it.
So we're nearing, like, close to running out of time. So I want to ask you this. What two, and I'm saying two, but you can say more if you want to. What two things would you advise someone who wants to be a brother, a better brother, to be, you know, even we can make it an extension, they want to be an ally. Like, what would you say one or two things or more to someone who wants to be more of a friend, a brother, an ally?
The first thing I would say is you have to develop a skill that most of us don't do well, which is listen. And by listen, I'm not meaning hear enough what I'm saying to create your next statement in your mind. Because if you've done that, and I'll tell everybody, if while I'm talking, you're already preparing a response, you've never listened to me.
Nope.
So the first thing you need to do is listen. And by listen, that means almost be completely silent and take the words that they're saying. Listening is actually such a sensory experience. It's not just with the ears. That's the first part of it. But it's listen, just take in the emotion. You know what I mean? Try to live in, you know, my wife says it best. She always says, Can you locate yourself in what they're saying? Good, you know, good or bad.
So can you locate
the first? Yeah. Okay. Can you locate yourself? And she said, if you can locate yourself in anything that I'm saying, then I would want you to do X, Y, and Z. And we just say that, she says that around the house, whether if I'm not doing the dishes, like it's a real thing. But
so
yeah,
it's really
listening, like with a really like a keen ear, because when people are talking, they're not just saying words, they're expressing their doubts, their fears, they're sharing their joys, all of that. So if we really learn to listen, and then second, it's when you have finished listening and you have a directive, or you can figure out a place to act, just in what's going on right now. I mean, just in life. I've got a friend of mine who, he doesn't say a lot of words, but this guy, if you say something, if you just mention something in passing, he'll go do it. A friend of mine was thirsty, and she was sitting in the room with us. She was thirsty. He snuck out the back door, got in his car, drove down the street. She said she wanted a Coca-Cola. He got an ice cold Coca-Cola and brought it back. He just to do it. And I continually, like, I keep him very close to me, because he's like my mentor in, he's my mentor in servanthood. And I ask him, I say, why do you do the things you do? And he says, because I can. That's his response. So it's listening. And once you finish listening, act. You just act.
I hope people who are listening are writing, you know, some of these nuggets down. So the first call to action is to listen. And as
and
you're listening.
Really listen. Like, and it's a skill that not a lot of people have. A lot of us, the majority of us, and this is me included at times, we only listen to the point where we can add something in, or we can rebut, or we can, that's why some arguments, most arguments can be fixed if we just listen.
So true. That's so true. That's so that beyond, you know, that's, you know, relationships, that's marriage, that's friendships, that's every single area. Okay, so listen and act. Well, look, let me read this last quote from Malcolm X, okay, which states, I believe in the brotherhood of all men, but I don't believe in wasting brotherhood on anyone who doesn't want to practice it with me. Brotherhood is a two-way street. And I find that really compelling, because it does take two. It takes two people. It takes someone to listen, and then to act, just like you said. Are you still with me? I'm not sure if you're still with me. Maybe you got caught up. You got caught up in the matrix.
Listen, but what's happening?
Did you hear me?
This message is so good that everything that's trying to come against it, we can continue it. We can do it over and over again. I'd love to. We do it on the phone anyway, you and I. But
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no. Exactly. You know, we're freeing people today.
Yes.
So that's what we do.
I believe so. Well, look, in 2 seconds, please tell people where to find you on social media, and you know, how to stay connected to what you're doing.
The IG handle is @ For Men of Color, FORMENOFCOLOR. And the group is called Proverb, PRVRB. You can reach out. Are a black male who really needs connection. Join us. It's a free group at facebook.com/proverb. Can't wait to see you. And anybody who wants to love and support.com, PRVRB.com.
That's what's up. So look, I appreciate you, man. I love you. Before we go, I want to give you this this little quiz that I have. That I call it Think Fast, and looks like we have.
Oh, I've been waiting to do it. I've been waiting to do
very,
it.
Very little time. So let me hit you real quick with the summer or winter.
Summer.
80s or 90s.
90.
Doing all the things or doing none of the things? Cake or pie?
Cake. 100% cake.
Tropical island or mountain oasis?
Ooh, tropical island.
Keep the peace or fight like hell?
Oh, fight like hell.
Spotify or Tidal?
Tidal.
That's a tough one, yeah. Thought leader or quiet observer?
I'd like to insert one. It is Shadow Warrior.
Shadow Warrior. Yo, yeah. I like that. I like that's dope. I like that. That's dope. Dave Chappelle or Chris Rock?
Chappelle all day.
Fashion star or fashion victim?
Oh, I'm a fashion victim. Ask my wife.
You are not a fashion victim, bro. I've seen some fashion victims.
Oh, I know. I'm one. I'm Papa Smurf. I wear the same thing every day.
You're good, man. You're good. The Cabbage Patch or the Dougie?
Oh, the Cabbage Patch, bro.
Always early or always late?
Always early, but everybody knows I'm always late.
I kind of have that same problem. Fixed mindset or flexible mindset?
Flexible mindset.
Group project or flying solo?
Group project.
Pancakes or waffles?
Pancakes. 100 cakes.
Introvert or extrovert?
Introverted extrovert.
I don't know why, but I knew you were going to say that. 2020 or 2021?
2020.
For such a time as this, I'm telling you,
yeah.
It's purposeful. Sleep in or up at the crack of dawn?
Up at the crack of dawn. Getting it done.
My hat goes off to you, bro, because I sleeps all the way in. Look, full suit or blazer with jeans?
How about t-shirt and jeans?
Oh, hey. It's your world, man. It's all good. You can remix, you can add whatever you want to do. High fashion or fast fashion?
Ooh, no fashion.
No fashion. Oh, that's right, because hey, it's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, that's fine.
Black or black? A little bit of a trick question. Crisp white tee or crisp white button down?
Crisp white tee. Crisp tee all day.
Tupac or Biggie?
Biggie. I'm an East Coast dude, man.
Yeah,
Biggie.
East Coast.
Biggie.
In this together or every man for himself?
In this together. 100%.
And lastly, a close acquaintance or a close brother?
A close brother. All day.
I love you, man. I really do appreciate you. I really do.
Dude, I love you too, man. I do. Seriously. I do. And that's one thing we don't say enough to each other as men and as black men. I love you, brother.
I love you too, man. Seriously. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for dropping knowledge on people. I feel like we need to do this again. I feel like we just scratched the surface. I'm not sure. This topic or another topic, but on that note, bro, it's microphone drop. I love you. Peace and blessings.
Peace, brother.
Talk to you soon, man.